By the end of this video, hopefully you'll get a really good understanding of reversible and irreversible reactions in open and closed systems. Now, this video I'm going to run a little bit differently. So up in your top right-hand corner of your screen, I'm going to put a link, and that link is going to take you to a free resource that is going to help you to make some observations about some chemical reactions I'm going to show you. So I'm going to do some demonstrations in the lab, and while I'm doing those demonstrations, I want you to record down your observations of what you can see. When enough of both reactants are present in a system, then the reaction can go to completion. So this is where all of at least one of the reactants is completely used up, and so the reaction is no longer able to continue. It's finished. Often, however, chemical reactions don't go to completion. A reaction that doesn't go to completion is often reversible. A reversible reaction is one in which the reaction can occur both ways. The reactants can react to form products. We call this the forward reaction. And those products can be reverted back into the reactants, and we call this the reverse reaction. Chemical reactions can occur in both open and closed systems. An open system is one that is free to transfer energy and matter with its surroundings. But a closed system is one in which no matter can enter or leave the system. However, energy, usually in the form of heat, is able to be transferred into and out of the system. In this video, we're going to explore chemical reactions in both open and closed systems and identify whether they're reversible or irreversible. So by now, hopefully you've downloaded that free resource and you've printed it out and have it next to you. I'm going to show you some chemical reactions, and while I'm showing them to you, I'd like you to make any observations that you can. So have a look at, you know, the way that reactants look before reacting, make some observations about how they look after reacting, how the products look, make some observations about what happens while they're reacting, and also try and identify whether it's an open system or a closed system, whether you think that reaction is reversible, and whether you think that reaction has gone to completion or whether it was an incomplete reaction. Okay, here's our first reaction, and this is burning magnesium. So in this experiment, I'm going to burn magnesium in order for it to react to form magnesium oxide. So start by looking at the properties of the magnesium before it's burnt. So here's the magnesium here. What can you observe about it? And now let's see what happens when it starts to react. So it's now a light. So it's now burning. Gets a bit blinding, so you might not want to watch it directly. In real life, you shouldn't look at that flame directly because it can damage your eyes. And now that reaction has stopped, let's look at the product that's formed. So this is the product of magnesium oxide. What can you observe about the magnesium oxide? Are there any similarities or differences to the magnesium before it reacted? And have a go at ticking those boxes there as well. Is it open and closed system? Do you think it went to completion, or was it an incomplete reaction? And do you think it's a reversible or irreversible reaction? The next experiment we're going to look at is the reaction of cobalt chloride and hydrochloric acid. So here, this is before we react it. This is the cobalt chloride solution. Make some observations about the color, whether it's transparent or opaque. Those are the sorts of words you might like to use here. And now I'm going to add some concentrated hydrochloric acid. So here it is after it's now reacted. So we've got the cobalt chloride and the hydrochloric acid have reacted together. And now I'm going to add some water. What happens when we add water? What observations can you make there? So for part two of this experiment, I'm actually going to look at the same chemicals again, but this time I'm going to put it in a hot water bath and a cold water bath, and we're going to see what happens when we do that as well. This is the cobalt chloride and hydrochloric acid solution in a hot water bath. This is the cobalt chloride and hydrochloric acid solution in a cold water bath. Experiment number three is burning of steel wool. So steel wool is made up of mostly iron, and we're going to form iron oxide when we burn it. But before it reacts, let's have a look at the properties of that steel wool. So what observations can you make? What does it look like? Is it malleable? Is it not malleable? And this is it reacting. What observations can you make while it's reacting? And this is it after reacting, and I've got some fresh steel wool here just so you can see the differences between them. So on the left here, you've got the burnt steel wool, and on the right, I have some fresh steel wool. Okay, the next one we're looking at is nitrogen dioxide gas. So what I have here are three vials of nitrogen dioxide gas. Have a look at the color of it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to put one in hot water, one in room temperature water, and one in cold water. And I want you to make some observations about what happens there. Okay, so hopefully you've had a go at recording your observations for each of those experiments. And now I'm going to go through and explain what it was that you observed and hopefully were able to communicate on your notes and why it was that you observed those things. So with the burning magnesium to make magnesium oxide, words you might have used to describe the magnesium before it burnt could have included that it's shiny, it's got a silver metallic color, it's bendable and malleable. And these are all properties of metals. So when you're observing a metal, they're the sorts of words you would use to describe them. While it's reacting, we can see that there's energy being released in the form of a light. So we know it's a chemical reaction occurring, and it is an exothermic reaction. And then when we look at the product that's formed, the magnesium oxide, we can see that it's got a white sort of ashy color. It's not shiny. It is brittle, it breaks apart as soon as I touch it, and it's got this powdery sort of consistency. Now, is it an open or closed system? Well, because we didn't have this happening in a sealed jar, it was actually out in the open and we were able to use the oxygen just from the air. It is an open system. Now, because it was in an open system, this reaction was able to go to completion, and that's because the magnesium was able to react with excess oxygen in the air. This reaction is not reversible. So how do we know that? Burning magnesium is an exothermic reaction, and that means it's actually more stable as magnesium oxide. Now, magnesium oxide does not decompose to make magnesium and oxygen. This means that the reaction is not reversible. We say it's irreversible. Okay, onto the cobalt chloride and hydrochloric acid. So before the cobalt chloride solution, before we react that with the hydrochloric acid, we can see that it's a really nice pink color and it's transparent. And that's because of the complex ion that is formed between the cobalt and the water molecules. Hydrochloric acid before reacting is a clear liquid. Then after reacting, what happens? So when we add the hydrochloric acid, you can see a color change. And this color change is into a blue, still transparent color. And that is because the cobalt has now formed a complex ion with the chloride ions from the hydrochloric acid. Now, when we added more water, we can see that the color now returns to more of a pink color. Yes, it is more dilute, so you should include that in your observations. It's a more dilute color, but it's still that pink. And so we can see that the reaction has actually been reversed, that now the pink color is back because the cobalt has more water molecules to react with. And so it's forming that complex ion again with the water molecules. Is it an open or closed system? This was an open system. It's not sealed, and we added matter into the system. Did it go to completion? No, the reaction didn't go to completion. The reason we were able to reverse it was because there was still some of the reactants there in the solution. Is it a reversible or irreversible reaction? We've already established that it was reversible. Okay, so the next part of that experiment was looking at the same reaction, but this time we were adding heat energy and removing heat energy. Now, when we added heat, adding heat causes some of the water in the solution to evaporate. And so that means that there's less water. And so the cobalt actually reacts with the hydrochloric acid again. And so that's why it turned blue. When we removed the heat, so we put it in a cold water bath, this reverses that reaction. And so it turns pink again. Is this an open or closed system? We have to say that it's open because those test tubes are not sealed. If those test tubes were sealed, we could call it a closed system. And that transference of heat can happen without the transference of matter. So we should expect to see the same result. But in this experiment, the demonstration I've shown you, the test tubes weren't sealed, therefore it has to be an open system. Burning the steel wool. So before burning the steel wool, we can see that it is shiny and it's metallic and it's bendable and malleable. And you'll notice those sorts of words, we use the same ones for the magnesium. And that's because they're both metals. We expect them to have very similar properties. So you can observe the difference in color after the burning, and that product that you see, that difference in color, that is iron oxide. This reaction again occurred in an open system with excess oxygen. And so that meant that the reaction was able to go to completion. Is it able to be reversed? Can I unburn the steel wool? The answer is no, it's not reversible, and the reasoning is the same as what we saw with the magnesium oxide. So it is an exothermic reaction. The iron oxide is more stable than the reactants are, and the iron oxide will not decompose to form the iron and the oxygen again. At the nitrogen dioxide gas. So before reacting, the nitrogen dioxide is a nice dark brown color. And when we put it in the hot water, we actually see that color get darker. When we put it at room temperature, that color is fairly constant. Okay, and then cold water, we see a lighter brown. Now the reason for that is that the nitrogen dioxide is reacting to form dinitrogen tetroxide. And the dinitrogen tetroxide is a clear or transparent gas. It's not brown. And so if there's more of the dinitrogen tetroxide, then the color in the tube is going to become lighter because there'll be less and less of the nitrogen dioxide. Now, when we put it in hot water, what we're actually seeing there is the dinitrogen tetroxide is dissociating into nitrogen dioxide, and that's the brown gas. And so we actually see more and more of that being created or being produced when we put it in the hot water. Now, is this an open or a closed system? This is a closed system. We have sealed tubes. No matter is being transferred or can be transferred into the system. Did it go to completion or was it incomplete? This was incomplete. At every point in this experiment, there were some reactants and some products, just the amounts of those varied. And is it reversible or irreversible? Yes, it's a reversible reaction. So we were able to swap between the forward and the reverse reaction just by adding or removing heat energy. So in conclusion for this video, some chemical reactions are irreversible, while other chemical reactions can be reversed in both open and closed systems. In a closed system, if a reaction can be reversed, then it hasn't gone to completion. So there's still some reactants available there. However, a reverse reaction won't reach what we call an equilibrium unless it is in a closed system. And we will look at equilibrium reactions specifically in an upcoming video. Let me know what you thought about doing this video a little bit differently. Let me know what you thought about the free resource and whether it helped you with your understanding in the comments below. Thank you.